Very good morning to one and all of you. And as usual, my very, very special thanks to Dr. Rohit for having me here. So I think I really feel I missed a lot of discussion by not being here yesterday. And probably what I would be saying would be just a summary of the events already discussed. But anyway, here I am. And it's going to be about advances in cross-linking. This quote comes to our mind, like when people asked this individual, what's the best role you have ever played? And he said, the next one. And probably cross-linking has been moving on in this tempo, always trying to seek one frontier after the other, of course, with a lot of questions unanswered here and there. We are all aware that there are two processes of cross-linking, and it's the type 2, which is most active, with the release of signet oxygen, which brings about the cross-linking at the substrate. We also know that there is some amount of ambiguity as far as when you would do the cross-linking, but we do realize that we need to have a documented progression in at least 3 consecutive maps, but we would get aggressive when it comes to a pediatric, and a pediatric with a VKC with rubbing, we would get even more aggressive. We would definitely be cautious when in a pregnant woman, because we are really not so clear that whether she could withstand the period of pregnancy without a need of cross-linking. And again, in iatrogenic ectasia, where the pathophysiology could be a little different. I'm not going to go into all the details, just lead you on. We are all familiar with the Dresden protocol. There's no doubts on that. We also know that the radiant exposure to the different layers of the cornea is actually far less than the damage threshold, which is again a very encouraging fact. So the advances which were happened were largely these. So then taking you on from one, when it comes to cross-linking in a thin cornea, we are familiar that you could use a hypoosmolar riboflavin, a transepithelial approach, use contact lenses as was discussed, or use a tailored stromal lenticule overlying, or go ahead and do an iontophoresis assisted cross-linking. The hypoosmolar cross-linking would have the first 30 minutes with the isotonic cross-linking riboflavin, and the last 10 minutes you would use the hypotonic riboflavin for the treatment. But then we need to keep in mind, we need to factor in that there is an increased intraoperative time and there is going to be a lower concentration of collagen in the hydrated stroma. Then comes the transepithelial approach, wherein you're not debriding the epithelium, you're using paracaine or EDTA to do the cross, to break the epithelial barrier. So of course, the stiffness evidence was there of cross-linking, but it was definitely clear that it was not as effectual as the standard cross-linking. In fact, there were a huge number of papers which came in, and one of these papers tell us that 23% of keratoconus eyes in the transepithelial group continue to progress, and that has to be kept in mind. Then the questions which came up, do we increase the viscosity of the solution? Do we try to change the osmolarity properties, or do we actually look seriously at the iontophoresis approach to enhance this transepithelial approach? Then again, it came up that the demarcation lines were quite superficial in the transepithelial approach, and does that mean that that is not the way to go? The other one was the use of contact lenses, which was a sort of an explosion of confidence which came in people that we could go ahead and treat thinner corneas, but there were problems therein because the absorption properties of the contact lens was different. We could not customize the thickness of the contact lens, and there could be buckling of the contact lens and with pooling of riboflavin, which will lead to non-uniformity of diffusion. Maybe a stromal lenticule seemed to be more reasonable as it would conform to the shape of the cornea, but the availability of the lenticule was the next worry. So then came thought of using iontophoresis cross-linking, wherein a small electric current was passed and it enhanced the ionized drug penetration. And we are all aware that riboflavin is a negatively charged structure and this diffusion would definitely get accelerated. So an annular suction ring was used, 0.1% riboflavin was used with its enhancers, and the current was passed, and the irradiation was 10 milliwatts for 9 minutes. Definitely to understand, we need to analyze the results, and we did this was a paper where they did a 12-month follow-up and found that there was a halting of progression, there was a reduction in the higher order abrasions, and improvement in the best corrected visual acuity, but that there was no demarcation line. Rather, there was an increased reflectance only. So does that mean that the CXL effect was not effective? This is a question which is left unanswered. While all this was going on, the different cross-linking processes were going on, it was essentially the different riboflavin formulations which came in with the different vehicles, which sort of encouraged us to move that one step forward. Accelerated cross-linking came up with the understanding that if our total fluence remains constant, that could be a way to go to shorten the treatment time. And there were different options which opened up, but different papers told us that going beyond 45 milliwatts for 2 minutes was definitely not the way to do a cross-linking. So then again, when you talk of accelerated cross-linking against conventional, you need to know why it is the way forward. So then the different answers, it came up that it was definitely safe in arresting the progression, but the 3 and 9 were better than the 18 and the 30. Then we looked at the visual acuity. It was found that the trend was more favorable for the 3 and the 9 milliwatt protocols. You then looked at the keratometry. There was flattening in all of them, but the flattening was more in the 3 milliwatts and lesser as you went down, increased the path. Then the depth of demarcation line was again more significant in the 3 and the 9 milliwatt protocols and was getting patchier with the 18 and the 30. So then, what we understand from all of this is that yes, by speeding up the cross-linking, probably there was a challenge about the amount of oxygen which was available. That is, the oxygen which was being depleted was not being adequately replenished. So that could be the reason for the lessened efficacy for these high energy protocols, because we clearly know that a hypoxic environment is not congenial, and rather it would end with a suboptimal cross-linking. So then came the thought that why not do pulse oxygen, which was so beautifully discussed in the earlier talk. Like, instead of using 30 milliwatts for 4 minutes, you could use 30 milliwatts for 8 minutes with 1 second pulse on and 1 second pulse off cross-linking. And then they found that yes, it was definitely, there was an arrest of progression, there was a deeper demarcation line and similar safety profile. While all this was happening, there was a further interest in treating keratoconus eyes, not just cross-linking them, but improving their visual acuity. Because we all knew by cross-linking, we were stiffening the cornea, but we needed to improve the quality of the vision, for which it necessitated that we do some kind of a surface regularization of these corneas. And the first few papers which came as an explosion was by Canalopoulos and Binder, and many more papers came forward to tell us that there was an improvement in the UCVA, BCVA, astigmatism, max K reduction, and all of this based on the knowledge that when you're doing a topo-guided PRK with cross-linking, what you're essentially doing is flattening the steep cone in the center by doing a myopic ablation, and then you combine it with a hyperopic ablation, which lifts up the flatter cornea, so creates a larger, flatter, broader cone, which could better withstand the intraocular pressure and the biomechanical strain. And it makes sense that you treat the cornea and then cross-link it and lock it as it is, and thus get a more optimal result. However, this could be done only for a mild to moderate keratoconus with centered cones largely, though you could do decentered cones too, have a thickness of at least 450 micron, not ablate more than 50 micron, understand that you're just debulking the cornea refractive error and not treating all of it, and you could probably venture to use smaller optic zones to address a larger refractive correction. So there's a typical profile wherein the patient started off with a VCV of 612 with a centered cone, and following the treatment, there was a significant improvement in the BCVA to 66 and a more happy and a satisfied patient. The next question which automatically comes up, would you do both of it in the same sitting? Would you do simultaneous or sequential? And there were a lot of explanations for each of it. Simultaneous makes sense because it reduces the duration of work doing it at the same time. And anyway, by doing a cross-linking, you're taking care of the haze of the PRK, which is one thing which is sensible to do it at the same time. And does it make sense that you cross-link and then you ablate? Because then you're removing the cross-link tissue. The other doubt is there are no nomograms which are there for a cross-linked cornea. And most importantly, if you're able to remove the Bowman's, then the penetration of cross-linking would be more effectual. So there were a whole lot of hands which were raised that yes, we do a simultaneous cross-linking only, and there were different studies, 3-year study, 2-year studies, enormous studies which came up that the results were quite stable, and this was a way forward. But let's understand, we are not looking at emmetropia here, we are just treating the cornea to improve the quality of the vision, and we would have to customize it based on the corneal thickness and plan an ablation zone on a case-by-case basis. Then the next thing is, would you use mitomycin when you're doing this? I believe that I would use mitomycin in my, and we've been successful in our series of eyes because cross-linking takes care of the stationary keratocytes, but mitomycin is going to take care of the migrating keratocyte fibroblasts, which could add on to the component of haze. Then there were innumerable questions which came up at that stage, and our intelligent minds had their own answers for it. As far as epithelial debridement, PTK was seemed to be make more sense than a mechanical debridement because it not only removed the thinned out epithelium over the cone, but also uniform amount of stroma, giving regularized corneal surface and a better quality of vision post cross-linking. Then came the thought of intrastromal ring segments with cross-linking. It made so much sense that if you could reshape the cornea to a more physiological cone and then cross-linking, it would be the way forward. Then would you do it at the same time or at different sittings? It made sense to do it at the same time, though the results were nearly equal in both ways. But if a cross-linked cornea, you do the intact segment creation is done, it was noticed that there was some more haze which was there and a little more difficulty in place passing the intracorneal ring segments through these cross-linked cornea, but then this was definitely possible. But one thing which came is, if you could do it simultaneously, the newly dissected channels, there was greater pooling of riboflavin, which seemed to give us an exaggerated flattening of cross-linking, and probably it made sense to do both of them together. And there were again huge number of papers which came forward to tell us that you should go ahead and do use your intracorneal ring segments with cross-linking as and when indicated. You could also do a phakic ICL after cross-linking after ensuring a wait of 6 months to a year after the refraction stabilizes and the topography stabilizes to an extent. Then came a new thought, why not combine this magic procedure with laser vision correction process too? Because we knew that regression and ectasia are manifestations of weakened biomechanical strength, and cross-linking seems to contribute to the biomechanics, a better biomechanics of the cornea. But then the challenge was the haze and the scattering, which you all know which happens with cross-linking, and could you do that in a laser vision correction? But then what came to our awareness was that after all, the total fluence which you're going to use in an LVC could not contribute to the haze, and these were the different indications for thinking of combining cross-linking with laser vision correction. However, you would not use dextrin as a vehicle, but sodium chloride, because dextrin could actually cause DLK. So the fluence which is used here is 2.7 joules, and you would use 30 milliwatts per centimeter square. You apply riboflavin for 90 seconds, and then irradiate for further 90 seconds, and this was the standard protocol used largely. However, if you're doing it with a flap-created femtosecond laser, you would avoid cross-linking the flap because it does not contribute to the biomechanics, and in fact, there would be flap shrinkage. Then there were a host of papers which told us that in high myopes, in high hyperopes, the regression is addressed if you could cross-link. There was again a paper which compared LASIK extra with LASIK and said a 1-year study which told us that it was quite stable and a way forward. Then again, this is a typical case of a high myope with a decent corneal thickness. All the indices are quite normal, the Bellen and everything is normal. But keeping in view that in a high myope, even in a thicker cornea, if it makes do a cross-linking, regression is addressed. I'm still not too clear whether this is the right thing which you're doing, but we've been successful this far, and this intelligent audience could tell us their own thoughts on it. Again, I would combine mitomycin in all of these situations too. Then came the thought of doing customized cross-linking based on the understanding this whole disease is a focal disease, and why not focally treat on that cone rather than treat the entire corneal surface? And Brillion microscopy further told us that the viscosity of the cornea is more affected in the cone than in the other areas. So it further sort of pushed us to go and look at cross-linking in a customized manner. In fact, the surrounding areas were nearly normal as compared to the weakened area. So then there were different protocols of doing customized cross-linking at different energy levels. Different patterns were decided. A KXL2 system was used. You could do an arcuate pattern, or you could concentric pattern with greater energy at the cone and lesser over the areas. And we did this study in 30 eyes, wherein we found that every single index, the inferior superior asymmetry, the K-mean, the K-max, the BCVA, all of it had improved. And this definitely sort of indicated to us that this should be brought into consideration. In fact, we could actually see the clear demarcation lines in the area of cone than in the other normal area. And for the stable endothelial counts was more encouraging. This is a typical situation wherein a patient started off with a BCV of 612 and definite improvement in the symmetry of the cornea and a customized cross-linking, and of course the reduction in the higher order aberrations. All of these things encouraged everyone to think that we need to concentrate further in go ahead and looking at customized cross-linking. Although there were different papers with different proponents coming with different energy levels and different durations and different designs of cross-linking. The next area was the pediatric cross-linking. We all know that in the pediatric cross-linking, there are 88% of the younger population which could cross-link within 1 year, and more so in this kind of an intense VKC. So then probably it indicates that we should do cross-linking regardless of the stage and evolution of the disease when you're doing a cross-linking. So then probably in this kind of a limbal stem cell deficiency, it indicates that you treat the VKC and protect the limbus and treat these eyes. But however, what remains to be understood that a longer follow-up is needed in these younger patients, and topographic regression is possible and has to be viewed on. Transepithelial approach could be left only for those habitual eye rubbers or a cornea thinner than 400, or the epithelium is not healing well, wherein we should be realistic that the progression would be done. I have just few minutes to go, barely. And then again, the other area of interest is a post-LASIK ectasia. We all know that cross-linking a flap does not make sense at all. And we are sure also know that the pathophysiology of these ectatic eyes is different because the diffusion rates were different. But then that was the only treatment which we had at hand at this moment of time. The other one is adaptive fluence, which was so beautifully discussed, which makes you wonder, would you treat 250 corneas too and salvage the situation in those eyes? And would that be the future? And of course, there was this novel approach which was experimentally tried in our center as in some of the select centers, wherein a transepithelial approach was used to treat small refractive errors, because we do know there is some refractive effect of cross-linking and there is some amount of flattening which occurs in these eyes. And there were different patterns which were used for myopic correction, hyperopic and astigmatic corrections. And it was found that there was a reduction in the refractive error and there was less of regression. And this could also be thought as a way of treatment with greater and greater studies. But the questions remain: how much ectasia would you treat? When would you treat? What would be your attempted correction? What would be ablation depth? What would be the dosage of CXL? But then, this old order changeth, yielding every place to new, is the word of Lord Tennyson. And probably 2 years down the line in the same audience, we would be talking something entirely different from what we know today. I know the audience is diverse here, but before I conclude, because I have this large audience, I would look forward to your support for the post which I'm trying to contest for the chairman ARC for the February 2020 elections. Please remember me. I would do my best. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.